On behalf of Torrey Harris Integration Solutions, I welcome you to today's meetup session on the topic AI and crowd management. Prince this side, I will be one of the speakers for today's session, having experience in AI, ML, and backend technologies with the Center of Excellence. And along with me, I have my colleague Kavi Arasan. Could you please introduce yourself to our attendees? Over to you.
Thanks, Prince. Hey, everyone. I have worked on many projects within the organization for the past 3 years. I have experience in AI and ML. I would like to name a few like sentiment analysis, emotion recognition via speech and audio, forecasting, crowd management in AI and ML. In this session, both of us will deep dive into the challenges and approaches of crowd management through AI and ML. Now, Prince will be walking you through the introduction of basics of AI and ML. Over to you, Prince.
Thanks, Kavi. First of all, we will be looking into what is AI, what is ML, and what is deep learning. Then we'll look at what is crowd management, why do we need crowd management, what are the challenges and approaches to crowd management. Then we'll look at convolutional neural networks and try to understand what they are and how they work. Then we'll also try to understand how convolutional neural networks can be used in crowd management. Then we'll look at some code snippets and a demo of the application. I will also be giving you a brief on Foresight, an analytical tool powered by Torrey Harris. So first of all, what is artificial intelligence? It is a bigger concept in computer science to create intelligent machines which can mimic human intelligence and behavior. What is machine learning? It is an application or subset of AI that allows machines to learn from data without being programmed explicitly. Basically, when we talk about machine learning, machines have to learn from past experience. And when I talk about past experience with machines, it will be historical data. Then what is deep learning? Deep learning is a machine learning applied on large data sets. So let's try to understand the relationship between AI, ML, and DL with this image. So as you can see, deep learning is a subset of machine learning, and machine learning is a subset of artificial intelligence. So there can be few instances where AI can exist without the use of ML or deep learning. And to name a few, it can be chatbots or expert systems. So these systems were basically built using if and else conditions without using any machine learning. So these are a few examples of AI without ML. So what are the different types of learning which we have in machine learning? So we have three: supervised, unsupervised, and reinforcement. So let's try to understand all three of them with simple examples. So first of all, we have supervised learning. So when we talk about supervised learning, we will have an external supervision on the machine. It can be in any form. There can be a domain expert, or we can get it in the form of files or in form of other data. So here we can see that the machine has a cubical object in its hand, and someone is telling the machine, a cube has six sides that are a square. And machine replied, I understand. So this is a simple example of supervised learning where there was someone else involved, and that person told the machine that the object which it is holding is a cube, and it has six sides and all of them are squares. So from next time when the machine sees a cube, it will understand that it is a cube. Let's try to understand what is unsupervised learning. So we can see from the example that the machine is having four objects, two cubicles and two cylindrical objects, and it has grouped them together. So how did the machine do it? There was no external supervision involved in unsupervised learning. So how did the machine do it? So when we talk about unsupervised learning, in this machine will inspect the objects. So here the machine inspected all four of the objects and it decided that two of them are similar. So it placed them together in one category. And then again it inspected the other two, and again it decided that these two belong in a single category and it grouped them together. So this is unsupervised learning. Then what is reinforcement learning? So basically in reinforcement learning, machine will try out all the possibilities, and the goal of the machine will be to increase the amount of reward. So where does the reward come in picture? So let's try to understand with the example which we have here. The machine has a cylindrical object in its hand, Say the machine put the object in the cubicle slot. When it put the object in the cubicle slot, it will get a reward, a very low reward or maybe a penalty. Then the machine will try the other possibility. It will pick up the object and put it in the cylindrical slot. It will get a very high reward. So the machine will understand that it had to, in order to maximize the reward, it has to put the cylindrical object in the cylindrical slot. So it will start repeating this behavior. So this is an example of reinforcement learning. So what is the flow of traditional machine learning? So when we talk about machine learning, basically we know that we will need some data. We will need to select an algorithm. We will need an evaluation criteria, and we will train a model based on the algorithm. And after training the model, we will check with our evaluation criteria. If the model satisfies our evaluation criteria, we will select that model. So let's understand with the flow diagram how it works. So first of all, we have a data source. We take the data from data source. We prepare the data. We generate some training sets. And then we select our algorithm evaluation criteria. And we train a model based on the algorithm. After training, we check the model with the evaluation criteria which we have. If it passes the threshold value, then we select that model. And that model will be called optimal model. And then we deploy that model and we constantly monitor it, so that if there is any drift in the model, we will retrain it. So this is how traditional machine learning works. Now let's try to understand the difference between deep learning and machine learning. And we will understand this with a real world example. So let's take an example of Twitter. So in case of Twitter, whenever people tweet on Twitter, Twitter classifies the tweets based on some features in a polite and offensive. So who is attracting those features and how are those features coming into the picture? So in traditional machine learning, we will have a domain expert. Domain expert will extract the features, and based on those features, we will have a classification model which will segregate the tweets between polite and offensive. But when we talk about deep learning, we can see that there is no domain expert needed. Deep learning architecture itself is handling all of that. It's extracting the features and then classifying based on those features. So we can see that deep learning is a huge improvement, and it provides a huge advantage over machine learning, as it removes the need of domain expert and it completely automates the process. There is no need of human involvement at all. So from here, my colleague Kaviarasan will be taking you through crowd management and its approaches and various challenges faced in crowd management. Over to you, Kavi.
Thank you, Prince. That was nice information to share about basics of AI and ML. By seeing this picture, can anyone able to say how much number of people are gathered in this event? Okay, we can't predict, right? Yeah. So for human eyes, it's very difficult or hard to find how much number of people are there in this event, right? So we have to rely on someone where they can actually help us to gather those information on behalf of us. So to whom we have to rely on? Machines, right? So how we will train or learn, make the machine to learn accordingly so that it will give appropriate result by counting the number of people in this images or event. So that's what we are going to see in the upcoming slides. Okay, Kumbh Mela. As you see, this is the largest religious gathering on earth. Here, government has initiated an idea where they will use AI to manage the crowd and to monitor the suspicious activity. First of all, my question is, why they actually thought we have to use AI? Why AI? Basically, AI helps us to take smart and precision decision over some analysis in any field. So here they thought human eye cannot able to reach the massive crowd to catch the suspicious activity in a crowd. So they installed 2000 cameras in 3200 hectares, so they can able to find the massive crowd access, and they can able to monitor the suspicious activity. Now we will see the applications of crowd management. Population counting, safety and surveillance, as I showed in the Kumbh Mela as an example, traffic control, queue management, and disaster management. These are the sum of the applications of crowd management. Now we will see the challenge we will face while we are able, why we are creating the crowd management tool. So before going into the approach, here I will give some basic challenges where how we will overcome those challenges in the approaches we will see in the upcoming slides. Perspective variation. Perspective variation in the sense where how and which angle the image were taken based on the CCTV camera perspective, the photographer perspective, the image will be there. So due to the change in the variations, the some of the information will last. Second one is like low resolution. So if you guys are taking some picture, right, you need that picture to be in some good quality. But if not in good quality, you feel like, okay, that information is not up to the thing you expected. So machine also needs some information where it should give some more information about the input, right? So this is one of the main challenges we will face in crowd managing tool by creating occlusion. Occlusion in the sense, due to more number of objects or clouds present in an event or an area, some or many number of people or object may get occluded or hidden due to the more number of crowd. This is one of the major thing we will face while approaching the crowd management. So diversity, changing diversity. Due to change in the diversity also, some information may get lost. So based like example, concert, music concert, which are taken in the night. So some place it will be, some images will be taken, some events will be placed in the daytime, it will be taken. So input will be taken in the daytime. So due to change in diversity also, some information will lost. So these are the main challenges we will be facing while creating a crowd management tool. So approaches, now we came to the approaches part. There are two approaches for creating a crowd management. One is traditional approaches, second is modern approaches. In traditional approaches, there are three methods: detection based, regression based, and density based estimation. In modern approaches, where we will be using network architecture. Now we will see deeply into those methods one by one, where we can able to understand what it does and what are the limitations that approaches has. So first, we will see the traditional approaches. Detection based, as everyone knows about this detection based method, I think actually, because it actually detect the number any objects from an images or a video. If you see in these images, the machine tries to detect the objects which are in the foreground, but it can't able to identify the images in the background due to the image is not clear, so that machine unable to understand those information in the background. So this is one of the limitation we will be facing in detection based, where it can able to find only the objects in the images where it can be able to find, machine can understand. So other information will be get lost. So this is one of the limitations in detection based. So next approach is like, sorry, method is like regression based, where you will convert an image by detecting a low level informations or low level features from it, and you will be summarizing those features to get a appropriate result. So by evaluating this model, what really happens is like, we will be removing the spatial information from the images. So if you see, like, if I am removing some information to take only the core information from the input, so that time what is happening, while you are removing those information, some of the main information which are very near to those spatial information are removed, right? So that what happens, information are getting lost here. So due to that also, our regression model not giving that much accuracy compared to the others. So this is one of the limitation we face here. Third of method is like density based estimation, where it will analyze the density of an images by mapping the distance between the every people, and it will form a density by taking those density information as an input, and it will summarize and it will give the output, desired output from an input or image or a video. So here what actually it does, right? It actually preserves the spatial information. In previous method, if you see, the spatial information is removed out to detect only the lower level features. But here, it is using the spatial information also, and by using hard detection level on that, it's taking the necessary information and converting those information into density and summarizing those information. By applying density based here, I can actually localize the person very accurately. I am localizing the person very accurately, the count at different places and different distance can be handled, and occlusions also are neatly handled in the density based estimation. So from the previous two methods, you can say like, okay, so we can actually use density based estimation itself, right, to create a model for crowd management tool. But there is one limitation here. What's that limitation is called hand features, handcrafted features. You can ask, what is handcrafted features? Handcrafted features is nothing like, okay, where my machine need an expert domain to take the necessary information from an image by applying some of the algorithm. Then again, I will treat those information to the another machine, so that machine will understand those information and it will give the appropriate result. If you see here, expert domain become the tightly coupled here. We need expert domain and we need another machine to take those information also. So this is major limitation where we were facing in density based estimation. Now we have seen about the traditional approaches and this methods, right? Now we will see about the modern approach also. In modern approach, we are using network architecture. As everyone knows, ANN, like artificial neural network, deep neural networks, which these topics are considered under network architecture, where the nature of the neural network is like, if you give any input like digits or input images or video, what it tries, right, it will take the information which are needed for the machine to train. It will try to take the necessary information, meaningful information from the input, and it will train those information by applying some feed forward and back propagation, and it will give you the appropriate result. So we have seen the three methods, how we will use network architecture to overcome those limitations. If we ask, in density based estimation, if you see, there are limitations like handcrafted features. We need expert domain, right? In network architecture, machine itself will try to take automatically the meaningful features and in-depth features from the input without the need of expert domain. So if you see here, handcrafted features are getting eliminated, and due to it's taking the information on its own, it won't leave the spatial information also. So network architecture is better to use than the previous methods, as everyone can think like that, right? So which approach we have seen the four methods in the two approaches, right? So which approach we have to use? So we proposed a model like where we combine the network architecture with the density based estimation to give the appropriate result. So in network architecture, I am going to use the convolutional neural network combined with the density based estimation. Now, till now we have seen like applications and what are the approaches and what are the methods we have. Now newly some topic came called convolutional neural network. So we will see like what is convolutional neural network and how it's used. Convolutional neural network, actually it's a powerful network architecture in a neural network that specializes in computer vision tasks and image recognition. So advantages of using convolutional neural network, like it will share the parameters. It has some methods to share the parameters and to handle the sparse values. Due to sharing the parameters, the very low information will be shared so that it will give the meaningful information out of it. And due to I am sharing the parameters, I am reducing the number of parameters also. So if I reduce the number of parameters, what is happening actually? I can able to speed up the training also, right? So if I speed up the training, means I can actually reduce the computational cost also. So we are actually going with the convolutional neural network. We'll see how convolutional neural network will work in the upcoming slide. There are some methods which are used by the convolutional neural network. In this, we are going to see about two methods called convolve method and pooling method. Here, first method is called convolve, where if you give any input, a video or an image, it will have less information about those frames, right? Those input image, input data were taken or extracted from the images, then we will be applying some filter or kernel over those image. So what is happening? It's trying to apply dot product with a filter, and it's taking the necessary information or the meaningful information from the input by sharing the parameters. While I'm sharing the parameters, the value which are very less, like sparse values, are handled very easily. If you see, for example, first consecutive 3x3 matrix, I'm applying 3x3 filter here actually. You can actually apply 4x4 also, 2x2 also, according to your business meet. Okay. So here I'm applying 3x3 filter, where the dot product is applied. If you see, it is multiplied with the zeroth and one. The zeros are the very less value that are handled very nicely to get the meaningful information from that. So this meaningful information is called convolved feature or feature map. So I got the feature map. What I am going to do with the feature map? That we'll see now. So second method is called pooling layer, where you will take the output of convolve layer and you will apply some method. What are those methods? In pooling method, there are two types. One is max pooling. Second is like average pooling. We are actually using max pooling to take only the highest number out of it. Here I'm applying 2x2 filter, where it consecutive 2x2 filters values were taken. From those values, I am taking only the highest number. So why I am taking the highest number? So for example, if you have an image and you think dot is also present in those images, if you analyze the dot, if you take the pixel values or extract the information from of those dots value, there will be n number of values will be mapped to the dot, right? So if I take only the highest value from those information, it will give the same information which were seen before, right? So what's happening really here is I'm reducing the parameter in pooling method, and I am leaving the unwanted information and taking only the meaningful information and significant information from the images, and I'm converting into the pooling layer. So these are the two methods we are actually using in the convolutional neural network. Now see, we will see the how full flow of convolutional neural network will works with this architecture. Here I have taken an example of and return digit, where it contains 28x28 of input. So I am applying 5x5 filter over the input. Okay, so what it does, it will apply the filter to the input images, then it will try to take only the meaningful information from it. If you see, I am applying 5x5 kernel, where it will take only the meaningful information. If you see, 28x28 information is converted into 24x24 by handling the sparse value. It was shared actually here. So from this convolved feature map, what I'm trying to do, I'm going to apply the second method called max pooling, where it is 2x2 filter. Now, what I'm doing, I'm taking only the significant information I need, right? So if you see, the parameters are reduced into half. Then I'm again applying the convol on max pooling method. If you see, I have given the input of 28 cross 28, which is 786 input for one image, okay? And I got the final layer of 4 cross 4 into N2, which is 16. What if I sent the 28 cross 28, the value itself, to the network? What happens? It will overfit, right? Because you have thousands of images, okay? One image contains 786 data means other 1000 images also will contain 786 data. So it will class 7 lakhs, or sometimes due to your training data, it will go like crows also. So due to avoid the overfit, we are applying the convol one pooling method. And we are actually flattening those information forming into a vector. Then we are applying for backpropagation feed forward method to analyze the final report. So for this input, I'm sending the input image as 5 means I will be getting the nearly like 4.9 or 5 from the output. So this is how convolution architecture works. So we got to know about everything like methods, approaches, and how convolution neural network works. So what and all libraries will be used to create an crowd management tool that we will be seeing in the upcoming slide. Here we have used H5PY, SkyPy, PIL, NumPy, Torch, CV2, Torch Vision. H5PY is to load and save the model, where after I trained the model, I have to store those information in somewhere. So I'll be storing those information in an instance and loading those information from an instance where it contains the weight information. SkyPy and NumPy will be used for technical and scientific computing. NumPy used for high level mathematical functions. PIL stands for pillow, where it gives supports to opening and manipulate those images from a CCTV or a video as an input. And CV2 solves the computation problems. Torch is the application library where we will be used for computer visions and natural language processing. Torch Vision will contain the meta information like modern architecture of every neural networks. So from here, we are actually loading the architecture type for convolution neural network. Code snippet. So here I'm going to show some of my code snippet, where it contains like how to load the data, how to load the model, how we are transforming the new input, and how it's actually predicting the results. So this is what we are going to see in the code snippet. First, I already trained the model. We already trained the model where actually we are actually instantiating those model, and I am loading the model from the path where I am storing, and I am running the model in a CPU mode. If you want, you can actually run your model in a GPU mode. And I am taking the necessary information like weight value, right, which are stored inside the model. I am taking and I'm instantiating in the model. So I have loaded the model. So next step is like transformation. Why I have to do transformation? If any new data comes, my mission has to understand, right? It should understand some pattern. It can't process every data, right? So I have to apply some transformation technique to those new input. So what I'm doing, I am converting the information into a tensor, and I'm normalizing the data where my model should understand and process the data, and I have to give the appropriate result from the data. So we have seen the how to load the model and how to transform the model, the new input. Now we'll see how actually real time it is handled. If I am actually in an event, I'm placing a video camera. By using the CV2 library, it will start taking the information from the video. So from each frame, it will be taken and it will be stored in a path. So from those path, I am actually transforming the data. Transforming in the sense where it will apply the transformation which I spoke about. Then it will unsqueeze it. Unsqueeze in the sense where it will convert into a long vector to send it to the model. where my model contains a network architecture, understand that pattern and process the data and will give the result out of it. So this is how the model has been created, and this is how we are getting the appropriate output from the model. Now I will show you a small demo by uploading some one or two videos to my model by an API. We actually running this model by an by exposing it as a service. So I will be passing one or two small videos showing and send it to my model where how it's processing the data and how it's giving the result. We will see it by now. Okay, here I have two CCTV videos. First, I will upload one CCTV video and I am sending it to my model. So what here happening is it will take the information from the video as a frames, and it will process those frames, and it will take the information from the frames and it will apply convolve and pooling method into that. Then it will send it to the architecture, and the results have been predicted and it will be given in this endpoint. So what really does is like the flow which I told from the convolution architecture, it will be the pattern is followed and we are getting the necessary appropriate result out of it. So if you see, I uploaded the one video, right, where it contains 60 frames per second and it took processing time of 36.77. time frame 1 contains 158, time frame 2 contains 161. I will show you the input file itself. So this is the video I given as an input to my model in a API endpoint. So it will take this video as an input, and it will, as I told, it will pre-process the information whichever from the frames from whichever it's grabbing using the CV2 library, and it will send it to the model. It will apply the every method which I explained before, and it will process the data and will give the necessary output. So we see, as per the video here, my model I gave the buffer size as 10 seconds. So from the video, from each 10 second it will take the frames and it will process the that frames, and it will give the appropriate result out of it. So for that first frame it predicted as 158, for the second frame it predicted as 161, right? So I will show you the second video before itself. If you see the same somewhere it took around some other place. So I will be passing this as an input to my endpoint. We'll see how it's predicting the results. Okay. Now I upload that input I have sent to my model. So my model need to understand, as I told. So as I told earlier, it will do the pre-processing in 1 minute. And it will apply the transformation technique to that input, and it will give the appropriate result. So I have got the logs, right? So if you see, okay, you can think like, okay, I have seen only the number of people in a frames. Okay, so for every event, I will get only the number of events. So what I will do with the number of events? We'll see about that in the upcoming slides. I think it's taking pretty long time. We'll see. Okay. Yeah, it has given the response. So it has given the date, time when it's uploaded, on the same frame per second. Processing time, it took 50 seconds because from this video, it took the T3 time frame, and first time frame contains the 127 count, and second time frame contains 138 count, and third time frame contains 143 count. So I have got this information, right? So by using this information, what I will be doing? We'll see that now. First item, I have installed CCTVs in a certain event for past 4 to 5 years, and I have taken some logs, right? So what I have to do? I have to do some analysis over that logs. So for doing analysis, I need to use some analytical tools, right? So in that place, where we are actually using Foresight as an analytical tool to collaborate with the crowd management. In deep, Foresight will be explained by my colleague Prince. Over to you, Prince.
Thanks, Kavi. So is my screen visible?
Yeah, for me.
So Foresight is a general analytics and prediction framework powered by Tory Harris. It can take the data, perform analysis or make predictions, and accordingly help in making visualizations. So we used it to take the output from the crowd management tool to get crowd density and forecast the number of people for an event. As we can see from the screenshot, like, the UI is very intuitive and it helps in connecting data sources and performing an action and visualizing it. And we also have some other options, like we can set some filters and we can set some time range, and we have other options as well. So let's look at some of the key features of Foresight. So what are the key features of Foresight? So we can have multiple data sources and we can make our custom data fields. We can create custom widgets specific to users or teams. We can create prediction models from the UI without writing a single line of code. It can also be integrated with other applications with the help of API or widgets. It also supports different visualizations, be it line, pie, bar, or any other visualization you might need. Now let's take a look at some of the key benefits of Foresight. So it can be used with existing application. We can use multiple data sources and perform some operations on it. It supports multi-tenancy, built-in prediction models to help make the processing easier. And we can control all of the aspects of analytics and predictions from the UI. We can also change and retrain the model from the UI. And if we already have an existing Elasticsearch setup, we can reuse the Elasticsearch setup for Foresight. So these were the key benefits of Foresight.
Before ending this session, we would like to give some heads up on the next event we are going to present. That is violence and social distance detection, where we will help you, or we will explain you how AI helps to detect the violence and social distance detection. You can find us on the corporate social media channels, and you can actually stay up to date with us. We are concluding this session. Follow us and get the updates from us. Thank you. Bye. Good evening.